My dear brothers and sisters, good morning to you. Let us begin the conference. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our reading from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 12, verses 38 onwards. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered Jesus, saying, Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you. But he answered them, An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great sea creature, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here. Let us pray. God our Father, as we enter into the third day of our retreat, we seek your blessings. You have been guiding us towards inner freedom. Today, as we reflect with the characters of Jonah, Elisha, and Mary of Bethany, make us realize our own shortcomings, pitfalls, temptations in our affective layer of our life, that being rid of them, we may continue to embrace inner freedom. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Once again, good morning to you, my dear brothers and sisters. This morning, we have our conference on Jonah and Elisha, a minor prophet and a non-literary prophet. The theme will be moving from anger to acceptance. So for the past 2 days, on the first day, we started our reflection with Jesus as the epitome and the giver of freedom. And we moved on to travel with the patriarch Jacob. Then we traveled with David. We reflected on the character of Samson. And today we are going to reflect with Jonah and Elisha in the morning. And in the afternoon, we'll have a discussion on Mary of Bethany. Let us continue our reflection. These are the summary pictures of the reflection that we go to have today. Stories of two prophets. Jonah is a minor prophet in the Bible, while Elisha is a non-literary prophet or non-classical prophet. Non-literary in the sense he has not written anything as Isaiah or Jeremiah have written. So that way they are non-literary, but still they are classical in the sense they belong to the so-called the classical prophecy era of Israel. The theme here is depression generates depression, kindness generates kindness. These two pictures, we have the first picture where Jonah is thrown out of a belly of a fish. And in the second case, we have some kids. They are making fun of, and they are mocking at Elisha. Elisha is entering into their village. And they are playing a game and they are shouting at him, Baldy, Baldy, like looking at his bald head. But that triggers Elisha's anger, and Elisha does something worse from which is expected from a prophet, and we'll see that what happens in the story. So the themes would be depression and anger. Background to story one, the story of Jonah. The cultural context, let's understand. Jonah is going to preach in Nineveh. Nineveh is the capital of Assyria. In 722, what happens? The Assyrian captivity. Assyrians take over northern Israel under Shalmaneser, and they are there for quite a long time, and they get into relationship with people, and the outcome is the Samaritans. So the Assyrian captivity was the first major captivity that people of Israel experienced. second major one was Babylonian captivity. These two captivities had a great impact on them, in the sense after which they had great antipathy towards these nations, Assyria and Babylonia. This may happen in any country which is under colonial power. For example, we had been under British rule, and naturally there is a tendency to reject whatever comes from the West, except for some practical reasons. So that same type of enmity is there in Jonah. Jonah is a Jew, and he is hesitant to go to an Assyrian country, Assyrian city anyway, on account of his past experience. So that way, Jonah is reluctant. And the theological context that this book addresses is, are the Gentiles saved as well? Before Babylonian exile, Israel or Judaism, in fact, closed itself completely, not opening itself for any other people to come in. But after Babylonian exile, especially when they were released by Cyrus the Great, the Persian emperor, they realized that God can work through the Gentiles as well. So they begin to have an open mind towards the Gentiles. So maybe the story of Jonah, in a way, tells their struggle to integrate the Gentiles into their own faith. Like Jonah suffered, the people of Israel also suffered. And thirdly, the historical context is, in the book, we have a very vivid presentation of hatred that existed between Jews and Gentiles. Jonah is a Jew. He goes to a Gentile country, Assyria, Nineveh, and then he preaches the good news. But after that, what happens? God shows compassion. And Jonah, as a Jew, is not able to accept that. And Jonah is, in fact, mourning over it, that why God showed compassion at all. In a way, it has a, in the sense, every religion has a demonizing tendency. In a sense, it considers other people as demons and wants to get away with other people. So it may happen to our own religion as well. And that antipathy is there in the story. So the story of Jonah is not merely a biblical story, but a cultural story, theological and historical stories. That is a background. Now, why do we take to study Jonah? The reason is, for example, whenever we took a character, for example, we took the character of David to study our own self-conceit. Jacob was helpful in studying our duplicities. And Samson, we took to study our vulnerabilities. And why do we take Jonah? We take Jonah because he suffered from problem of depression. So depression naturally is an emotional state or a feeling, and a very strong feeling. But depression comes, in fact, from anger. In the sense, suppose I have a lot of works to do from morning to evening, and that makes me angry. In the sense, why I have to do all these works, and why constantly so many mails popping up, and why so many appointments, so many classes. So I have a tendency that creates a type of anger. And that anger, what it develops into depression, how? I have to handle all this. I have to handle the mails, I have to handle the phone calls, I have to handle people, everything I have to handle amidst my anger. So one side I have anger, on another side I have to go on continuing with my work, and that leads me to depression. Same thing happens to Jonah. Jonah is angry because he does not want to go to a Gentile place. But somehow God wants him to go, so he has to do that. So one side he has anger, and on another side he has to fulfill that responsibility. So when we struggle between our anger and responsibility, as a principal or as a provincial or as a student, we may have all these anger situations on one side, and another side the daily responsibilities that we need to completely to carry on. And this leads to depression. And there was a study conducted about 7 years before on priests and religious suffering from depression. And they found out these reasons. We may have other reasons as well. We'll discuss these reasons here, which the document mentioned. Number one, issues integrated to vocation, like celibacy, obedience, loneliness, and the pressure of too little time for multiple activities. So what would be an issue connected with celibacy? An issue connected with the celibacy would be like, I'm not able to manage my urges. Suppose I am a celibate, I am a chaste person, and we vow to be celibates and chaste. And that happens at the mind stage. Our body does not know that we are celibates. The body has its own course. The body has its own way of going about things. And there is always a tension between this bodily urge and my own mental decision to be celibate. So that could lead me to depression, in the sense I want to be a chaste and celibate person, but what happens, my body does not allow me to do that. So that conflict would lead me to that depression. Then secondly, obedience. Obedience is the most difficult vow that we might have experienced as a leadership position in our own congregation. In a sense, in obedience, what happens? Actually, in celibacy, at least there is only, if we break the vow of celibacy, it's only a problem of connecting two bodies. But obedience connects two wills, will of my will and the will of my bishop or archbishop or my provincial or my general. So when two wills are in direct contrast to each other, and there it leads to depression, in the sense I want to do one thing, but my bishop wants me to do something else, and that leads me to depression. Then loneliness, not necessarily our existential loneliness, in the sense everybody feels a certain amount of loneliness, but this is ministerial loneliness. This we could have experienced as parish priests, like we are celebrating our Christmas, and about 2,000 to 5,000 people gather for midnight mass, and you finish the mass and you come to room and you are totally tired. You don't have even energy to get up and drink a cup of water. And you just come out of your room, nobody is there in the campus. The focus lights are on and the serial sets are on and the perfume of the people still lingers around the place. And outside you come, the cups are there, the cake plates are there, everything is there. And certain amount of loneliness strikes us. And we tend to ask that time, what is really true? What is that real thing? Was it that people were there some 1 hour before me, about 5,000 people? Now nobody is there. So what is really true? Whether the limelight, are the loneliness. So this loneliness not only happens on Christmas Day, but on many occasions we may have this ministerial loneliness that may lead to depression. And the pressure of too little time for multiple activities. So you are a priest, we are a principal, we are a student, and a lot of roles we need to play as a son in the family, as a friend to our relationship. So many roles we need to play. And we need to play these multiple activities, but too little time for that, that leads to depression. That's number one. Number two, number of special, unique circumstances that lead to burnout. Like they identify, the job of the ministering person is never finished. For example, suppose we are a principal of a school and a teacher comes there. Morning she comes at 9 o'clock, evening she goes at 4 o'clock. That's all. She forgets the school afterwards. But as a principal, we can't forget the school like that. So the school occupies our mind 24/7. The parish occupies our mind 24/7. And the job is never finished. Like as a provincial, we are there and we might go for house visit, or we may go for home visit, or we may go to spend a day with our family members. That day also, we have to constantly be in touch with our communities, with our province, constantly calling them and updating ourselves with what is happening there. What does it mean? Our ministry never ends. Wherever we go, we are occupied our ministry, and that leads to depression. Number three, we cannot always tell if our work is having any result. This particular statement may have exception. For example, I am a doctoral student and I do my doctoral research, but at the end of the academic year, I can see the fruit of my research. So that is okay. I suppose I am a principal of a school I am training plus two students for their public exam, and they come out all sent up result I have, and I can see the result immediately. But in a parish, in a pastoral ministry, or in a social work, it does not always happen. Suppose we help a family come up from a point of view of social work, or we are in a family, we are in a parish, we are assisting the spiritual needs of the people, but we can't really see any change happening among the people. So people throughout the year, they come for mass, but they remain the same. Parish council continues to fight, finance council is not responsible, our religious don't cooperate. So that continues forever. Even with, we are there for 5 years, all these 5 years, nothing drastically has happened. So that affects us in a sense, what did I do for these 5 years? Nothing has changed in the parish. So that type of not seeing our result directly leads to depression. Then number D, the work of ministry is repetitive. Like we can predict all days, like morning 5 o'clock we get up, 6 o'clock mass, 7 o'clock breakfast, then this meeting, that meeting, school, I attend to the staff, I attend to the students, afternoon lunch, then continue, and evening prayer, then this day will be same for almost all days, maybe in a year, 360 days, of these 360 days, 300 days will be more or less same. Like the work of ministry is repetitive, that leads to depression. Then the minister is constantly confronted with people's expectations. Like people expected, like in a school, we have to play according to the expectations of the staff members, supportive staff members, students, parents. So constantly people bombard us with their expectations and we need to respond to them. And next one, the ministering person must serve the same people year in and year out. This also leads to depression. For example, we are in a leadership position, and for 5 years, for 10 years, same congregation, same province, same people we have to see constantly. And that will lead to depression in the sense. Oftentimes we want to get away from the people, but still we are not able. And finally, because of being an idealist, perfectionist, compulsive. So this is an internal problem that I may set an ideal to fulfill. So I am ideal priest or ideal student, and I try to achieve or live up to that ideal, that creates depression. Or I want to be perfect and I want other people to be perfect, but things are not perfect. Then I may have some compulsive ways of doing things. Like I want everything to be neat, or I want my staff members to be this way, that way. And that type of behavior also will lead us to depression. That is one type. Another problem we have often is problem of anger. And depression is the emotional state, but anger is the real emotion. So we'll take them shortly towards the end. Now we get to understand the first story. Actually, the book of Jonah covers only 3 days. The first day, Jonah escapes. Jonah travels in the opposite direction. God sends him to Nineveh, but he takes completely an opposite direction. Like God sends me to Madurai. So instead of going from Tiruchi to Madurai, I go towards Chennai. So that is a travel in opposite direction. Means that when I travel to Chennai, I will never reach Madurai. So in a way, Jonah completely wants to turn his back to Nineveh and turn his back to God's vocation. And Jonah is myopic in a sense, short-sighted. Jonah is not able to see the big picture. Jonah is saying only that God is sending him to Nineveh. He only knows about that, but he does not know that he could be a messenger of compassion, or he could be a messenger of peace, messenger of mercy. He's myopic about it. And he suffers, or he has 3 signs of depression. Number one, sleeping long. Number two, going in opposite direction. And number three, looking at the window. Suppose if we have depression, and if we have these symptoms or signs, we can easily say that we are a depressed person. A depressed person sleeps long. Okay. Why does he or she sleep long? Actually, when we sleep, what happens? When we sleep, responsibilities don't disappear. For example, we have to have a staff meeting in our school, and the staff will arrive at school at 10 o'clock. But just because we sleep there, The staff won't disappear. The staff will be there. Somebody has to go and address them. Somebody has to go and talk to them. But in sleep, what happens really? We tend to go into an escape mode. Escape mode from our responsibility. So that gives an escape, and sleep becomes a like a little or mini death experience. Like we want to die because we are depressed. We don't want to live. We don't want to meet our staff members or community members. We want to die. But we are still afraid to die. So what we do instead of dying, we take into a mini death. Actually, sleep is a mini death, and that is an escape mode from responsibility. Jonah has the same problem. We may also wonder when we read the book of Jonah, when people were struggling for life and they were shouting because of the storms outside, how this person was able to sleep? That's a really wonder because that much of depression he has. So even in our own community, the people who suffer from depression will sleep at any cost. So we may have a community day celebration or we may have a founder's feast, but still somebody will be able to sleep peacefully because that person may suffer from depression. Number two, a depressed person goes in opposite direction. This may happen in our own community also. Like at 8 o'clock, all will go for breakfast, but one will be coming out of refectory. Listen, that person would have either had her breakfast earlier or she would not want to face the community members. So all will go towards one direction. This particular person will take opposite direction. God takes one direction, Jonah takes opposite direction. And thirdly, Jonah looks at the window or looks at the door. Or Jonah is actually sleeping in the open space of the ship, which means directly you can see the sky. And this we have in the book of Tobit, where the father Tobit encounters a problem, that is, he loses his eyesight. Then Sarah, his future daughter-in-law, also has a problem that she marries for a 7 times, and all the 7 times the husbands die. So both these people are led into depression, and when they are led into depression, they go to look at the window. And when we are sad, if we observe our own behaviors, either we will look at the window, or we will sit at the door, or we'll go to terrace. Why? One thing, we want to escape through the window virtually. On the other side, we want to belong to the house, but we can't come inside the house because the house disturbs us. Therefore, we stand in front of the window and, in a way, try to escape. So Jonah has three symptoms, and we may have or we may not have, but still we may suffer from depression. Then number two, second day, Jonah is given the second chance. So God always gives us a second chance. Here, three conversions happened on the second day: Jonah's conversion, people's conversion, God's conversion. What is Jonah's conversion? Jonah preaches conversion. In the sense, Jonah changes his mind and goes to Nineveh and proclaims conversion. That is Jonah's conversion. And how does he do that? 3 days' journey, like the author says that Nineveh, to cross Nineveh, it takes 3 days. But Jonah crosses it in one day. What is the meaning of it? He goes almost running, which means he's not bothered that people really listen to him. Just he wants to fulfill the responsibility for name's sake. And that's why he took the one-day journey to cover the 3 days. And something beautiful happens. As soon as Jonah preached, from king to all, immediately they announce a fasting and they show the signs of conversion. That is something beautiful to learn from these people. Like they didn't ask, who is this fellow, or why is he coming, or what is this God, why is he announcing conversion, or what should we do? So no question was asked. Repent, finished. As soon as they heard the word repent, they started repenting, which means either they were waiting for that or they were very good people, and immediately they started their fasting, and that is their conversion. Third, God's conversion means God changes his anger to mercy and compassion, and God does not allow evil things to happen to the city. So three persons undergo conversion: Jonah, people from king to all, and God. And on the third day is actually a dialogue between God and Jonah, and the dialogue is merely centered on this particular emotion, despair or depression. Jonah starts the conversation saying, I told you already, like, why do you disturb me? In the sense, I told you already, he's telling God, I told you already that you are a God of compassion. You will change your mind constantly. So you don't come after me, or you don't take me in the mission. And God is trying to answer him. And here, Jonah tells twice, let me die. And God is asking, why do you become angry? God tries to teach him a lesson through a plant, which he allows it to plant. Then the worm consumes the plant, and Jonah is a little bit angry with God. And God asks him, why do you become angry? And God continues to say, will I not show mercy? So oftentimes, when we are angry, it leads to depression. But when we are compassionate to our own selves, okay, this is what I am, this is what my life is, let me be more compassionate to myself, then naturally depression disappears. So in the end, Jonah arrives at a different, altogether different conversion, where he is able to understand God's peace, but he does not react to that afterwards. Let us sum up the story. God is swift, Jonah is slow. Sailors are active on the sea, Jonah is sleeping. Kings and subjects are quick to act, Jonah is slow. So naturally, an angry person may be shown outside to be a fast person, but actually is slow inside. A depressed person naturally is a slow person, is a sleeping person. And Jonah comes across as a person who is depressed because of his anger. God teaches him to accept. Accept who you are, accept who I am, accept who people are. So once you begin to accept, naturally anger disappears. That is the story number one. Let us go to story number two, which is very brief. Non-literary or classical prophet Elisha is a chosen prophet of God of Israel, Elijah's successor, and he must have been a rich man, because when Elijah called him, he was plowing his field and he had a lot of servants also, which means Elisha was relatively a rich person. And Elisha is a miracle worker. He has worked more miracles in the Old Testament than any other prophet. Then the story here is anger of Elisha on children. As I said earlier, looking at the picture, Elisha is coming to the village. In the sense, he has been anointed now with the spirit of Elijah. Elijah is now taken by the chariot to heaven. Now Elisha has to start the mission. So the first mission, he comes inside the village. Like, he might have gone either to the fields or to the wilderness area. Now he returns to the village. There, some kids are playing, some children are playing. And if you observe, you know, any our own village situation, if any car comes, all children will run after the car. So even in our childhood, we might have run after all the cars or the bikes. But or whenever somebody walks in, naturally, villagers look at differently. In the cities, they don't mind. But in the villagers, they, as soon as they see you, they evaluate you. In the sense, how you look, how, from where you come, what type of dress you wear, or what type of luggage you carry. Everything they see, everything they scan, and everything they evaluate. And these children are very good at it. And they evaluate this particular Elisha. They do not know that he is a great one of Israel, he is a great prophet. He has doubled the spirit of Elijah. They don't know. What they know is only his bald head. And they are looking at the bald head. They are saying, hurry up, Baldy, Baldy, come on, Baldy. And about 42 boys, the text says. And Elisha is hurt immediately. In the sense, either he might have been hurt because the children were making fun, or he might have been hurt on account of his people who were coming. Maybe his servants might have come with him. So in front of humiliation, in front of servants, he couldn't tolerate. Maybe, for example, it can happen to us also. Suppose we go alone to a place and we are humiliated, no problem. We don't mind it because nobody has noticed it. But suppose I go with my friend or I go with my subordinate, especially, and I am humiliated there. I am angry because that my subordinate or my friend will spread the news there everywhere that this person was humiliated. So whenever somebody hears that humiliation, all the more I will feel humiliated. And that happens to Elisha as well. Either Elisha must have traveled alone, I think must have traveled with the subordinates or with the disciples or with a group of prophets. And that's why his anger is triggered. And what he does, he immediately utters a curse. Utters a curse, and as soon as the curse is uttered, two bears come from. So it's very cruel to notice the first story, the first episode of Elisha's cycle begins with a bloodshed. Bloodshed because a prophet could not control his anger. And after that, something strange happens. Elisha goes to Mount Carmel. Why does he go to Mount Carmel? To pray to the God of tenderness, compassion, and slow to anger. It's really ironical, contradictory. Like he is angry with the boys, he is angry with children. Now, after uttering a curse, he goes back to God and prayed to God, who is a Lord slow to anger. What an irony in the story. But something beautiful happens after that. God sends a kind woman into the life of Elisha, that is a Shunammite woman. She converted him with her kindness. So whenever we are angry or whenever we have our own emotional issues, God always sends persons so that we would experience kindness. Elisha, for the first time in his life, experiences kindness. And that kindness of an unknown woman, of a Gentile woman, is shown through her meal and through room people. And whenever Elisha crosses the town, this particular Shunammite woman, what she does, she offers him a meal. And it happens for a long time. And she tells one day to her husband, "Look, our prophet is coming here. So why don't we build a room for him in our upstairs?" And she builds a room, puts up a cot, chair, table, lamp, so that the prophet will rest for a while. From where Elisha merited this kindness? From nowhere. It's pure act of kindness of the woman. Elisha has not merited anything. So Elisha has not merited, but only through the kindness shown by this woman he is going to be converted. And after that, what happens? Elisha continues with a chain of good deeds. So Elisha immediately repays her with a son. So he will hold a son in arms. So he says, he promises, and the son is born to the Shunammite woman. Then one day the son dies, and Elisha resuscitates him for life and makes whole the poisonous soup. So the poisonous soup is made whole or made drinkable by Elisha. Then he gives bread to all, he heals Naaman, and he gets the axe back. He gives relief from famine. And Elisha also weeps, and finally, even after death, he does works. He does works of miracles. He does miraculous work. He works miracles. And that way, one day in his life, he showed anger, and that killed 42 young boys, 42 children, which that loss Elisha might have mourned over all along. And the kindness of this woman changes his life forever, and he becomes a truly kind person. And Elisha was angry, Jonah was angry. Finally, they are led to acceptance. So acceptance brings acceptance, kindness brings kindness, anger brings anger. So this is the summary of the stories we have seen. Story of a minor prophet Jonah and story of a classical prophet Elisha. Now let us analyze our own lives. Saint Augustine beautifully says, "No one who is angry considers his anger to be unjust." So every angry person thinks his anger or her anger is always justifiable, justified. We justify our anger, and that is a sad tragedy, because as long as we justify, we can't come out of it. only when we realize that this is wrong, I will be able to correct that wrong. But I give a reason for that, my action, I will never correct my action. And Augustine continues, it is much better for us to forbear from anger, passion, hatred. So he tells, anger will lead to, that anger as a passion will lead to hatred. So before that that anger turns to be hatred, we need to stop. That is the lesson from Saint Augustine. And now, why do we get angry? So there are two fuels for anger. Fuel concerns like petrol and diesel, we can say. Like petrol, fear and hurt, and that's one side. Another fuel is expectation. Like first one is fear or hurt. When I am afraid, actually I get angry. Suppose I have to address a group of people, maybe school children, about 1,000 children, on maybe some soft skill training, and that creates in me a type of fear. In a sense, whether how will I handle the children? I haven't handled a big group, or will I be able to communicate properly? That fear is there. And I go there, and what happens? The first line, students are talking, and immediately I burst into anger. All of you get out, or all of you stop talking. I burst out my anger because my fear of facing the children turns out to be anger. So fear fuels anger. In the flip side of fear is hurt. Suppose here, what happens here? The same example. The first row of children, the girls or boys who are sitting there, they have hurt me. How they have hurt me? I am talking to them, but they are not listening to me. Either they are talking to themselves, or they are sleeping, or they are indifferent. And that hurts me. And that hurt leads to anger. So one side is fear, another side is hurt. That's the first fuel. Second fuel is expectation. Expectation in the sense, suppose we have our staff members, office staff members. Staff members, we want them to be punctual. Or we want them to be here at 9 o'clock, but they come at 10 o'clock, 10:30, and they break our expectation. So naturally we become angry with them. So when expectation is not met, naturally it leads to anger. So these are the two fuels, fear or hurt and expectation. But the basic in between is that wanting is the common source. Anger comes because there is a lack in it, because there is a vacuum, and that vacuum bursts, and that vacuum bursts and becomes anger. Let me put here, expectation is not getting what we want, but fear is getting what we don't want. So the same example of training the children, expectation is what? Like, I expect that children have to listen to me. So, but these children don't listen to me. So I'm not getting what I want. So it leads to anger. And the fear is getting what we don't want. In the sense, I'm afraid that I may not be listened properly. So that is fear. So one side is expectation, another side fear. These are two common fuels of our anger. Now, how do we journey from anger to acceptance? Number one, first one, St. Augustine also has this saying, we are not punished for anger, but we are punished by anger. He tells in the context of lust, in the Confessions, he says, we are not punished for lust, we are punished by lust. So the very fact that we go after bodily urges, there is no punishment for that, he tells, because that going after itself is a punishment, because you will get a disordered mind. And he applies the same in the city of God to anger. We are not punished for anger, in the sense there is no punishment for anger. Like suppose I have punished I have become angry with the children in the school, and there is no punishment for it, because that anger is the punishment, because by being angry with them, I have disowned them. That children will never come to me. They will never get attached to me. So the very moment I get angry, I punish myself through that anger. So I need not expect any other punishment for anger. So we need to be very careful when we deal with anger. Then number two, direct it towards being kind. Suppose the same row of children, the girls are talking in the class. Instead of being angry, I could be very kind, in a sense, come girls, what are you talking? Or you don't want to listen to me, come. What do you want to say to the class, or do you want me to something say something different? Just you be kind to them. They may have their own issues. Like a staff member comes to my office late, 10 o'clock, 9 o'clock she has to come, but 10 o'clock she comes. So I become angry. But instead, I could have just had a kind word. Madam, what happened today? You didn't get a bus, or something not good with the family members, or what happened really? So that is being kind. So we are remembered for our kindness. We are hated for our anger. So better we direct our anger towards kindness. And finally, accept oneself and others. So basic element of anger is that my inability to accept myself. And that not accepting myself creates a vacuum in me, and that vacuum bursts into anger. And I need to accept myself and accept others. So here we have the example that I said about Jitu Krishnamurti, like observation without evaluation is the highest form of intelligence. Suppose let me explain here. And now we are talking and the conference is going on. And suddenly maybe Father Augustine leaves the room. Immediately I think, okay, that's the observation. We observe that Augustine is leaving the chat room or leaving the Google Meet. And that's observation. But immediately, as soon as he leaves, my mind begins to evaluate. And how does he evaluate? Why Augustine left now? He didn't like my quoting Augustine, or he didn't like this argument, or he heard it earlier. So my mind continues to evaluate him. And in the end, what happens? I lose my peace of mind. But instead, if I had done, okay, Augustine left, that is observation without evaluation. I don't evaluate. Augustine left, that's all, Augustine left. But I have nothing to evaluate there. So observation without evaluation is the highest form of intelligence. So here, same thing, suppose we apply to the first example I said, the girls are talking in the school, observation without evaluation. So only when you evaluate, you tend to be angry. So you just accept it. Okay, they are talking, that's all. So and the lady, the office staff is late, that's all. And we need not evaluate it. So acceptance without evaluation is the highest form of intelligence. And that intelligence we may aim at, as Jitu Krishnamurti says. And another principle that could help us is that we must love people not because of them, but in spite of them. In the sense, I am good to the children, not because of they listen to me, but in spite of they are not listening to me. So that is my kindness. So in spite of, like Elisha had the same problem. Elisha, suppose all the 42 children welcomed him. What he would have done? He would have either given them, he would have worked a miracle and give a great basket of fruits as a gift to their thing. If he had done so, what would have been the meaning? It would mean that Elisha was reacting because of the children's behavior. But suppose Elisha was kind, in spite of these particular children's mocking at him, then that would be kindness. So we need to act in the level of not because of, but in spite of. And when we act in that level, I think we can come out of our anger. Now let's conclude with a small exercise. And this you may take a screenshot or you may take it down after I send the PDF. Like ecstasies and agonies in my life and ministry today. Because from this afternoon onwards, our focus will be on our life and ministry. In a sense, our life may have its own agonies, its own vulnerabilities, but still there are ecstasies. So today you take some time to write these ecstasies. Like as a human person, what are my ecstasies? I have good health, I have good friends, and I can go here, I can go there. So I have a good work, that is ecstasy. And as a minister, either as a student or as a parish priest or as a religious or as a principal, what are my ecstasies? Oh, I have a lot of children, I have very good staff members, and I have very good parents. So they are ecstasies. And then the other side, I could have agonies. Our agonies could emerge either from our own inner struggles or from our own community or from people outside. Like maybe some people don't accept me, then that could be an agony. And a disappointment, like I want me to be placed in this place, but my bishop or provincial appoint me in another place. So that could be an agony. Our community life could be an agony. So let's try to point out these ecstasies and agonies. And often I have experienced when I share in the groups, people tend to write their agonies more first, ecstasies are less. But let's not repeat that. Let's have more ecstasies in our life, and agonies will surely pass. Good. Thank you. That concludes my reflection.